Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. He comes and he's high and lifted up. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
this morning. Father, we bless you. We welcome you here into this place. We ask, oh God, that you would anoint our hearts with your presence, that your presence would fill each one of us. Lord, that your Holy Spirit would overflow. Father, we ask that you would meet each heart in this place. Lord, we invite you to touch my life, to touch our lives. Father, we've come with needs, but we also come with a desire to praise you. So, Lord, would you meet our needs, and would you put a song of praise in our hearts, even praise to our God. We bless you. Yeshua, you truly are welcome here. In Jesus' name we pray it. Amen. You may be seated this morning. Hallelujah. Wow. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Such an honor to be a part of the family of God, to have been called to be his son or his daughter, to actually have been joined in fellowship and in family with each of you. You know what? I'm just going to ask you to do something kind of different this morning, but I'm just going to tell you to turn to the neighbor on either side of you and just say, it's a blessing to be a part of this family with you. You may not think you're a part of this family. You may be visiting, but just go ahead and turn to each other and bless each other. You know, it's a blessing to be a part of the family with you. Amen. Amen. You know, don't you appreciate each other this morning? And the thing that is so unique is that if we have called on the name of the Lord and are saved, he truly has made us brothers and sisters in his family. That's just an incredible thought. But it's true. And just like any family, we have some little eccentricities and idiosyncrasies that happen. But, you know, every family has the eccentric uncle or, you know, those controlling personalities and other things. But you know what? We're family, and we're blessed to be here this morning. Just as announcements, Sunday school is going to be dismissed after worship this morning. You will be told, children, when you can leave for your classes and teachers, but that will come a little later. We invite you to stay in with us this morning for worship and to participate. And also, as we've been doing the last couple of Sundays, the offering, the morning offering, will be taken up right after worship. So when the last song is done, you just plan on getting back to your seats as quickly as possible, and then we will take the offering. But don't let that stop you from coming up and worshiping as you feel led around the altar this morning. You know, I was very humbled and blessed last week. Encouraged, but just feel so unworthy of all of the gracious words and comments that you poured out on us as pastors and our wives and the cards, the gifts. And I know that there are probably thank yous and things from us in a more personal form by way of a card or something, but I just wanted to thank you this morning for that outpouring of support. I can say this, I really felt valued, and I thank you for that. You're so kind and gracious in your words. And I was humbled as I looked at that, and as I was actually jotting down some thoughts, I thought about how much each of you do in this church to make it happen. Some of you are incredibly busy, but almost everybody has something that you are doing. And I was very humbled when I saw the gracious words that came from you, even as you contribute so much. I just thank you. Thank you so much for those gracious words and those cards, the gifts. We were very grateful for every one of them. Well, Tierra Yoder, are you here? Tierra is going to be with us yet for about another 1.5 months, something like that. She leaves right after, or right before the end of the year, for a 2-year assignment in Colombia. And she is here to tell us about it this morning. So, Tierra, tell us what's going to be happening.
Okay, I guess I'll try and put this together this morning. They say when you're in a crowd of people, you should take the nerves away. You should maybe just look at everyone and think they're cows or something like that. So yeah, thought that would help, but it's not really. So maybe you guys need a moo yet or something. I don't know. I'm excited about sharing just kind of my heart and what God has led me to next. As well, as a lot of you guys know that I had been on a mission trip about a year, or no, 2 years ago, 2021. I had been on a six-month mission trip in Colombia with GTO. GTO is an organization that stands for Global Tribes Outreach, and they were based in Malaysia. Their huge focus, GTO, would be on the unreached people groups, and they were based over in Malaysia until 2020 when COVID hit, and then they all had to leave. So all the Americans got shipped out of Malaysia, and then they re-centered into Bogota, Colombia. So when I had signed up for my mission trip, I had actually signed up to go over to Asia, not to Colombia. I was like, oh, Colombia's not that great, you know. Who wants to go there? But I had signed up for there. But God took me to Colombia then, and GTO's focus is on unreached people groups, mostly in the 1040 window. That's what the organization's main focus is for. So ULTRA is the program that I went on. And ULTRA is a women's program. They also have a guys program, and then they have a co-ed program called CHARGE. So ULTRA, their mission statement would be a six-month discipleship program for inviting women to live a life passionately loving Jesus and empowering them to be courageous women of faith. Okay, so this was my team when I went. We had a group of six girls. The teams can only be as big as six girls. And then the next slide, that is just kind of the mission statement itself. It's a mission program for women, but it also includes traveling and different types of ministry. So you might be at one mission base in, say, Brazil for 2 weeks, and then you come back to Colombia, and then you go somewhere else for 2-3 weeks. So, I guess, why am I telling you all this? The organization had asked me to come back as staff for that program, for the girls' program. So I will be an overseer of the girls that go to all these different programs. So, yeah, I'm really excited about what God has done in bringing this all about. It's been a long journey. Definitely a cry in my heart since I left. I was there for 1 month, and I knew I wanted to come back or go back immediately. I never actually got to finish my six-month term because I had to leave at three-month marker for health issues. So I never got to finish, but it really is a story of God's redemption in it. They had asked me over these last 2 years to come back multiple times, and I was never able to because of health issues. And it really broke me in that, because it's like my heart was there, my heart was crying out to go there, and I couldn't. And so my cry was, God, you know, like, if I can't do this, then just take missions from me. I had the cry to do ministry for so long. And so I literally just told God, you have to take ministry from me then if I can't do it. But through that time, it was a time of really just surrendering it to God. And it was so hard because I felt like I was losing everything else. I was losing my health. I was losing a lot of other things in the process of it all. And it was the one thing that I held on to. And God, through these last 2 years, was something that he was like, you have to give that to me. you have to give it up. And I was just confused in it all. Like, God, why would you, why are you taking something from me that's for you and is so good? And I didn't understand. But it was in a trip that I took, I went back to visit some friends back in October of last year, 2022, that God really, it was like the final breaking of him really just giving it to God fully and completely and saying, if I never do ministry, then that's okay, because I give it to you. And it was the next month in November that the process started for me to actually go. I got the opportunity again to go back as staff for this altar program. So it really has been a story of redemption of God and giving it to him and letting him rewrite my story. So I guess wherever you're at in life, truly just give God your story and your script and your pen and let him rewrite it without any strings attached. I guess it's my story in that. So a little bit about Ultra, my role would be in it. I'd be into discipleship. I'd be an overseer of the girls that are coming onto the program. So I'd be an overseer and mentor, kind of helping them like work through the things that God is doing in their life, through, you know, the things that they're seeing and the changes, and so helping them through all of that, and then also finding contacts and being in contact with their contacts and booking flights and sending them off into different places. So that would be my main role. And then when the girls are gone, I get to plug into some type of ministry within the city. So I'm not sure what that is yet. I'm thinking a daycare. I have a really, really good friend in Bogota where she has a daycare for Venezuelan refugee kids. So that's what I'm thinking of doing when the girls are out of town, when they're on different trips. So that is kind of my plan at this point, but, you know, I'm not completely sure. I might be jumping ahead of myself, but let's see here. So I guess ways that you guys as a church can walk with me in this. I'm needing a church to walk with me in this because obviously you can't do this alone. The closer it gets, the bigger it looks to me. And I really am just like, I can't do this. It looks huge. So I really need a church to stand behind me and walk with me. And through prayer and encouragement are the biggest things that I need. Ways that you guys can pray for me in this. The current right now would be learning how to walk with these girls in their journeys, because everyone has a different story. And some of these girls have really, really broken stories. I mean, we all have a story, and we're all broken, and we all need Jesus. And so learning how to lead them well and how to walk with them in that. Leading and knowing discernment on how to lead them. Connection with the community there. I will be going into Bogota, Colombia. I don't think I said that earlier, but it is a Spanish-speaking country. So it is, definitely a lot of change. I'll have to learn a lot more Spanish, which I'm excited about. But Holy Spirit leading me in this. And then also good health. Currently, my health is doing really, really good, and I am so thankful for that. But, you know, there is always that chance that it could go, you know, go a little south. So definitely prayers for health in that. I definitely need encouragement over my 2-year term there. I don't think I said that either, but jumping back, it is a 2-year commitment. So I will be there for 2 years. So encouragement over those 2 years, whether it be through WhatsApp messages. Don't text me through like the Apple message thing, because I probably won't respond. But cards, I love cards. Back by the main desk office thing, I have my address, so you guys can send cards to my apartment building that I will, where I'll be living, so you guys can send cards. Yes. If you guys do send me messages and I do not reply, do not feel offended if I do not reply, because, yeah, life there is crazy, and you always have something to do there, but I definitely need encouragement in that. So pictures of what your life looks like at home, and then just messages of encouragement is really, really what I'm needing. I also will have an email update. I'll send out email updates. So if you guys want to be a part of that email update list, you guys can sign up back by the desk. There is a sheet of paper that you can put your email down, and I'll add you, send out hopefully once a month emails. I'm not sure how that will all look like yet, but I'll send out emails of what life will look like then. And then lastly, and the thing I don't want to say, but, you know, I have to, or don't have to, but I guess. GTO, if you go on Ultra, it is a self-based, like self-supported, you have to find your own funding for it. So if you feel led to give to me while I'm over there for 2 years, my monthly cost would be about $1,100 a month. So if you feel led to give, I would definitely appreciate it, be very, very grateful. And if you choose or want to give, like, kind of like commit a certain amount a month to me, you can come talk to me directly. That'd be really helpful. But, yeah, that is kind of, I do have a support team set up within the church. John and Karen are one of my support couples. Orlando and Sharon are a support couple. Karina is a support individual. And then I have an aunt that is a support individual as well. So, and my parents obviously are in that group. So they will, John will hopefully try to keep the church updated as much as I give him updates, I guess. And I really want to stay plugged into a church, because coming back, I know already it will be hard. Anytime you leave your church for a long time and then come back, I know it will be hard. So I want to stay plugged into you guys as much as possible and connected. So let me see here. This is my team that I'll be serving with. So the family in the middle is my pastoral couple there. Jay and Ruthie, and they have 4 kids. He is originally Colombian. I don't know if he was, I think he was adopted into the United States, and then they came back as the pastoral couple. Chris and Kelsey, I think some of you guys might know them. They, right there, they're from the area. They are the charge directors. And then the rest of the people are all Edge and Ultra staff, so guys and girls. So Edge is the guys program of what I just described, the girls. It's just a guys program. And then Charge is a 5-week program for, it's a mixed group. And they take you to one mission base, and then you travel, yeah, around. So, yeah. I think that's kind of all I have to say. I feel like I rushed through it really fast. And probably didn't explain things great. But, yeah, I'm excited for where God has brought me and the journey that he has me on. I know I won't be perfect at this. But I know that if I can simply be a person that directs them, I'm not the person who can help them, but I know that God can. And I think I can simply be one of the girls that directs them to God, and God can heal them. So That's kind of all I have to say. If it felt all blurry and smudged, that's okay. You can come ask me afterwards. I probably can explain it better later. So, anyways.
Well, thank you so much, Tierra, for sharing about that. We're going to want to, sometime before you leave, closer to that point, we're going to want to have a dedication prayer and a sending of you. But thank you for sharing this morning. And you heard the prayer list. Keep this young lady in your prayers as she prepares. And thank you for your willingness to answer the call of God and follow that passion, even as you surrendered it to him. Let him give it back to you in full measure. Yes, if we could, just briefly, we want to pray for her right now. So if you would just stretch out your hands from your seats, and we want to pray and just ask God's protection. God, I just thank you so much that you care for the people of Columbia. And Lord, you have reached into Ohio and touched the heart of a young lady, Tierra, and you want to take her there. And Father, I just pray that what you will do in her will be great and will bring praise to your name. And Lord, what you do through her will bring honor to your name in Columbia. Father, as she prepares to, in these final months to go, I pray that you would put a special anointing of grace upon her. Lord, that there would be a joy in her heart that would offset the sorrow of leaving behind a family and all of this, that the joy that is set before her would be great. And Lord, I pray that you would give her strength and clarity and wisdom. Father, I also pray for her support, that that would come in abundance, that that would be the least of her worries while she is ministering in these next 2 years. We just commit her to you and ask for your blessing to be upon her in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. Thank you. And now I would like to just read a scripture as a call to worship this morning. There's a lot going on in the world today that makes us depressed, that makes us sorrowful. Psalm 33 says this, "Rejoice in the Lord, O you righteous, for praise from the upright is beautiful. Praise the Lord with the harp. Make melody to him with an instrument of 10 strings. Sing to him a new song. Play skillfully with a shout of joy. For the word of the Lord is right, and all his work is done in truth. He loves righteousness and justice. The earth is full of the goodness of the Lord." Do you believe that this morning? The earth is full of the goodness of the Lord. "By the word of the Lord, the heavens were made, and all the host of them by the breath of his mouth. He gathers the waters of the sea together as a heap. He lays up the deep in storehouses. Let all the earth fear the Lord. Let all the inhabitants of the world stand in awe of him. For he spoke, and it was done. And he still speaks, and things are still done by his power. He commanded, and it stood fast. The Lord," notice this, "the Lord brings the counsel of the nations to nothing. He makes the plans of people of no effect. The counsel of the Lord stands forever, the plans of his heart to all generations. Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord, and the people he has chosen as his own inheritance. The Lord looks from heaven. He sees all the sons of men. From the place of his dwelling, he looks on all the inhabitants of the earth. He fashions their hearts individually, and he considers all their works. No king is saved by the multitude of an army. A mighty man is not delivered by great strength. A horse is a vain hope for safety. especially if I'm on his back. Neither shall it deliver any by its great strength. Behold, the eye of the Lord is on those who fear him and on those who hope in his mercy. Where is the eye of the Lord? On those who fear him and on those who hope in his mercy, to deliver their soul from death, to keep them alive in famine. Our soul waits for the Lord. He is our help and our shield. For our heart shall rejoice in him, because we have trusted in his holy name. And then this is the prayer. Let your mercy, O Lord, be upon us, just as we hope in you. I'm going to just invite you to stand as we continue to worship in song this morning. May the Lord add his blessing to this service.
We lift our hands and proclaim you are holy.
In this moment I praise you. In this moment I cry to your name in truth. Lay my life down. I surrender. I surrender. You are my hope in this world. You are the reason to live, the reason to love. You gave your life, you gave your blood to redeem me and to restore me. From heaven, you saw my life. You truly love me, Yeshua. You laid your life down. You surrender. You surrender. You conquered death and the grave. You overcame. To redeem me, to restore.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. This morning we bless you and we praise you, Lord. You're worthy of our praise. Lord, this world is in chaos, but only you are the answer. No politician, no political measure, no army, nothing will solve the problem. It's you, and it's the love that you bring into a human heart when they trust in you. Hallelujah. Bless you, Lord. Amen.
Broken, wild,
thy power throughout the universe stay. It seems my soul. My soul, my Savior God, to
Blessed is your name. Lift your hands.
The city of our King is Jerusalem.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We're going to sing one more song. Just a little story. This is actually, my son loves this song. I've sang this for him every night for years. Of course, there's some other songs, but this is one that he enjoys. And you see, our hope, and we know this, our hope's not in the politicians, our hope's not in leaders, our hope's not in those types of things, because we know history. History proves that there is always evil and there is always good, and there's always a fight of good versus evil, no matter who is in power, because there's two systems at work in this world. There's the kingdom of light and the kingdom of darkness. You want to break things down? It's that clean and it's that neat. But that system will come to an end, and we will receive a kingdom that is all light and not darkness. And the darkness will go away, will pass away. And that is when Jesus returns. And so we look to that day, to that moment that all creation has grown together in birth pains for, waiting for that manifestation, for the revelation of the sons of God and Jesus at his coming. And so we celebrate that future truth that we believe in, that it is central to our understanding of faith. We are different than Islam. We are different than Judaism. We are different than Hinduism, because we believe in Yeshua, Jesus. And so his word that he spoke when he said, "I will return," means something. He's intentional. He will return, but he will not return until Jerusalem says, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." What we see today in Israel is interesting. I don't know that I have all the answers, but we do know one thing, that Jesus is still waiting to hear from that city. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. So we look forward to that moment, whatever it looks like, when Jerusalem says, because Jesus said himself, standing on the Mount of Olives, "You will not see me again until you say." So we trust in his word. Amen. This is the last song.
Every nation and people, tongue and tribe, we must stand. of the tribe of Judah, the Messiah, the great I am. He's the Son of David and the Redeemer, the Savior of the world.
At this time, if you'd be seated, we're going to take up an offering through this time. And I'm just going to, as they come forward, I'm just going to say a little prayer. Lord, we bless you for your provisions and your provisioning, but we also give to you and to your name. And Lord, bless these hands who've worked for this, for these resources, and we pray that you would return it back to them manyfold for the effort that they put into it. Bless you in Jesus' name.
Good morning. In the name of Yeshua. Hallelujah. It's good to be here. And I'm going to dismiss the children for Sunday school. As well with my soul, that was the song that they were playing up here, and I'm so glad this morning. Aren't you glad that you can say it as well with your soul? If you can say it as well with your soul. I know I think it was Brother Matt, mentioned how that things are in a turmoil in the world right now, probably more than we've ever seen in our lifetime. And yet we, as believers, have such a tremendous hope because Jesus is not in the grave somewhere. His bones are not laying somewhere in a grave, deteriorated. But he's risen and at the right hand of the Father, and he's coming back for his bride, his church. So we have that great confidence. Brother John this morning, Pastor John, mentioned or gave note to all the gifts and the blessings that you gave us. And I want to do that too. My wife and I were actually quite taken aback by the gifts that were given and the notes of encouragement and everything that came from your heart. Just really quite astounding and thoughtful, just in the different gifts. Feel quite humbled, along with John and I'm sure the other pastors, feel quite humbled to be the recipient of such charity and of such kindness and generosity. And so my wife and I just really thank you for that. And Jesus said somewhere in the Gospels that, a servant, after he's done everything, what should he expect but to say, "I'm really unworthy." And that's how I feel today. So thank you again, and blessings to you for your generosity and for everything that you gave, because you gave part of your life. So thank you. Would you stand with me, please? And let's bow for prayer. Father, I'm so glad that we have a way to come to you, and it's through Jesus Christ, and through the blood, that we can come, and your word says even with boldness we can come. Lord, it's not always been this way. Under the old covenant and under law, it was not this way, but now you've made a way that we can come to you. And Father, I think of who you are, you who set stars into place and put things into motion. And we look at everything and we see what we believe is the vastness of space, but we don't really know, because we might be very small. We don't know. But you are greater than that, because you've made it all. And in the midst of your greatness and your majesty and your glory, yet you've desired a relationship with mankind, someone that you've made to have relationship with. And I thank you for that, Father, and I bless you this morning. Lord, as we look into your word, I look into your word this morning, I pray for assistance, for help, because I know, Lord, that unless you empower the words, they're just words of men, but they are not just words of men, they come from your word. But I pray for empowerment, in Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. I think it was last Sunday that Pastor Burnell ministered to us about growing in faith and adding to our faith. And so appreciated the message that he had. And just as a little bit of a foundation here, as I lay a foundation for my message, you know, the Christian life is to be a life of going forward. It's a path that we walk on. There is a destination, and we're headed there, but it is a journey. And it's said of Enoch in the Old Testament that he, what? Walked with God. He walked with God. So that means that he moved with God. That when God moved, then he moved too. He walked with God. And so I see, and the Bible teaches that this Christian life that we have embraced, as we embrace Christ and give our life to him, that this life as a Christian is a life of going forward. And it ought to be, because if we're not going forward, then we're going backwards. I don't know that there's a place, I don't believe there's a place where we can stand still and say that I'm there. I know there isn't on this side of eternity. In fact, in Colossians it says, as ye have received Christ, now, excuse me, I have a little bit of a run. I might need to blow my nose several times. I'll just say it that way. As you have received Christ Jesus, now walk in him the same way. You received him by faith. Continue your walk in faith. Ephesians says, be rooted and grounded in love. Let your roots go down and receive of the nourishment of God's love. The title of my message today is The Blood of the Covenant. The Blood of the Covenant. And we know that the blood of Jesus, is what washes our sins away. And that the blood is a vital part, an integral part of the gospel. But there's some other aspects that I see that sometimes maybe that we don't understand, and that's what my message is about today. The blood of the covenant. The blood of the covenant. And so I'll be speaking about covenant, covenant relationship. And in fact, you know, this Bible that I have here, the one that you have, is divided into two parts. And the first part is called the Old Testament. The last part is called the New Testament. But the word testament has the same meaning, or the same word as covenant. So the first part of the Word of God is the Old Covenant, and the last part is the New Covenant. So I'll be preaching about covenant and seeing what that means and seeing what it doesn't mean when it says the blood of the covenant. In Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6, it says, Isaiah prophesied, unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given. The government shall be upon his shoulder. His name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God. And then it says, the Everlasting Father, and then the Prince of Peace. So I want to look at that word Father for just a little bit. This is a prophecy of when Jesus would come. We know that he has already come, but back then from where Isaiah was, that he would come. And this was one of his names, is the Everlasting Father. Which is interesting, because in the Old Testament, or the Old Covenant, they seldom or almost never referred to God as their Father. In fact, one of the things that Jesus was accused of was that he said that God is his Father. That is in John chapter 5, verse 18. The Jews sought the more to kill him, because not only had he broken the Sabbath, but he also said that God is his Father, making himself equal with God. So this was a big complaint that the leaders had against Jesus, Then he said, well, God is his father. See, we don't hardly think about that today. We kind of almost take it for granted that we can come and say, our Father, which art in heaven. But in the day when Jesus was there, that was unheard of. Because in the Old Testament or under the Old Covenant, he was not known to them as Father. And as I looked through the Word of God, it speaks of him, but almost always in the sense of prophecy of this is who he will be. Now, he's always been the Father, but they didn't know him as that. They knew him as a distant God. Except for special people like prophets and priests. But as the regular general people, they knew him as a distant figure, maybe to be feared. In fact, when Moses went up on the mountain and God spoke to him, to Moses, and the mountain trembled and lightning came down on it. And when Moses came back down, the people said, you speak with him for us. Now, God had said that he wants Israel to be a nation of priests, a whole nation of priests for the earth. But the people, in a sense, said, Moses, you deal with God. It's too scary for us. So God is a father, and he's an everlasting father. What is a father? I want to speak a little bit about what it means to be a father. I believe it's under attack in America. I see that it is. That manhood, authority, being masculine even, is called toxic. So what is a father? In the very simplest sense of the word, a father is someone who begets? Don't often use that word. Another human being, just in a purely physical sense. And so if someone has a child, or we say they fathered a child, they would be the father of that child. But the true word father has such more of a deeper meaning than just that meaning. And if that's all that we know, and I see this as part of what's happening in America, that fathers are not standing in their place and are, for whatever reason. But the function of a father, for those of you who are fathers out here, the function of a father is a shepherd. It's a shepherd. What does a shepherd do? A shepherd provides for a flock in three different ways, primarily three different ways. He brings, and this, fathers, as I speak about this, my message isn't about fathers necessarily, but I'm just starting here with that. This is your function in your home. You're the shepherd of your home. What's the function of a shepherd? A protector? A shepherd is there when the wolf and the lion comes. And the shepherd is the one that stands between the bear, as David did, the bear, the lion, and he's the one that takes the attack. A father is a protector. To stand at the door of the house and to say, no, that's harmful, that can't come in here. That's the role of a father, a protector. There are things that you don't want to let into your home. It will damage your family. You, father, are the one that's responsible to stand there at the door of the house, if I can say it that way. You know, we wouldn't, if we would see someone standing on our porch with ill intention, armed with knives and guns, we wouldn't let them into the house. But sometimes we allow other things into the house that we ought not to. That will not damage physically, but will damage spiritually. So fathers, that's one of your responsibilities. The second thing is a director. A shepherd will direct the sheep where they need to go to find the pastures that they need and the waters that they need and the good things that they need. That's part of being a father. And then the third thing which is really the one I want to come to. The third thing that a father is responsible for as a shepherd is a provider. In fact, the Bible says that if one does not provide for his own, he's worse than an infidel. So fathers, and I believe we have very good fathers here. But being a provider, that is one of our responsibilities as fathers. A provider obviously of physical things, but then a provider of encouragement and a provider of spiritual sustenance, a provider of love. That's all our role as a father and as a shepherd. And that's who our Father is. That's who God is to us. He's a provider. Abraham knew him this way. And that day when Abraham was, or actually it was Abram then, when he was walking up a rough path up to the top of a mountain called Mount Moriah, and he was going with his son Isaac, he had fire and he had wood, and his son Isaac, that promised child, said, "We're going up the mountain. We have wood, we have fire. Where's the sacrifice?" And Abram said, "God will provide." And I believe he said that in faith because he knew what God had spoken to him in his heart. And then, as you know the story, in fact, I think maybe we'll turn now to Genesis chapter 15, and I want to read a portion of scripture there of what Abram went through. I'm going to read the whole chapter. "After these things, the word of the Lord came unto Abram in a vision, saying, 'Fear not, Abram, I am thy shield and thy great and exceeding reward.' And Abram said, 'Lord God, what wilt thou give me, seeing I go childless, and the steward of my house is this Eliezer of Damascus?' And Abram said, 'Behold, to me thou hast given no seed, and lo, one born in mine house is mine heir. And behold, the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, This shall not be thine heir, but he shall come forth out of thine own bowels, shall be thine heir. And he brought him forth abroad and said, Look now toward heaven and tell the stars if thou be able to number them. And he said unto him, So shall thy seed be. And he, Abram, believed in the Lord, and the Lord counted it to him for righteousness. And he said unto him, I am the Lord that brought thee out of Ur of the Chaldees to give thee this land to inherit it. And he said, Lord God, whereby shall I know that I shall inherit it? Or asking, But how can I be sure that I will inherit it? And then God said to him in verse 9, Take to me an heifer of 3 years old, a she-goat of 3 years old, a ram of 3 years old, and a turtle dove and a young pigeon. And he took unto him all these and divided them in the midst, and laid each piece one against another, but the birds divided he not. And when the fowls came down upon the carcasses, Abram drove them away. And when the sun was going down, a deep sleep fell upon Abram, and lo, an horror of great darkness fell upon him. And he said unto Abram, Know of a surety that thy seed shall be a stranger in the land that is not theirs, and shall serve them, and they shall afflict them 400 years. And also that nation whom they shall serve will I judge, and afterward they shall come out with great substance. And thou shalt go to thy fathers in peace, thou shalt be buried in a good old age. But in the fourth generation they shall come hither again, for the iniquity of the Amorites is not yet full. And it came to pass that when the sun went down and it was dark, behold, a smoking furnace and a burning lamp that passed between these pieces. In the same day the Lord made a covenant with Abraham, saying, Unto thy seed have I given this land, from the river of Egypt. This is an important verse, actually. Verse 18, In the same day the Lord made a covenant with Abram, saying, Unto thy seed have I given this land, from the river of Egypt unto the great river, the river Euphrates, the Kenites, and the Kenizzites, and the Kadmonites, and the Hittites, and the Perizzites,
and the Rephaims and the Amorites and the Canaanites and the Girgashites and the Jebusites. That was to be the land that Abram would take over. Now, this is quite something. What God did here is made a covenant with Abraham. Abraham had come back, Abram, from the slaughter of the kings. And then God talked to him. Said, you're going to have an heir. And I'm going to give you land. Abraham said, how can I know? And then God said, I'll make a covenant with you. And God promised to Abram the land from the river of Egypt all the way to the Euphrates River. And if you look at that on a map, that is more land than what Israel occupies today. But I believe, according to God's word, will occupy. God's promises always are faithful and true. In 70 AD, the Roman army, I think it was Titus, came in and destroyed Jerusalem, tore down the walls, and they scattered the people, drove them into other lands. And from that time until 1947, 48, when Israel became a nation, the people of Israel were scattered into many varied and distant lands and were not a country. But God says in His Word, let me see here in Genesis chapter 17, then verse 8, I will give unto thee, speaking again to Abram, and to thy seed after thee, the land wherein thou art a stranger, all of the land of Canaan for an everlasting possession, and I will be their God. Isaiah chapter 3, verse 5 through 6, fear not, for I am with thee. I will. Listen to this prophecy of Isaiah. Don't be afraid. I'm with you. I will bring thy seed from the east and gather them from the west. I will say to the north, give up, and to the south, keep not back. Bring my sons from far and my daughters from the ends of the earth. For I will take, this is from Ezekiel now, for I will take from among the heathen and gather you out of all countries and bring you into your own land. And you and I today are living in a time when we have seen this prophecy come true. Never was there a people so scattered across the face of the earth as the Jewish people, and yet came back and have a country. There are no more Amorites. There are no more Jebusites. There are no more Kenites. There are no more of all the other ites. The Perizzites and the Rephaims and the Amorites and the Canaanites. We don't know of any people like that. But we do know of the people of Israel because God's promises are true. And the people of Israel are God's chosen people. And He has promised them that land and they will have that land. As we see that promise has been established in as of, I think it's 1948. I just want you to see that God's ways, God's promises are sure. Sometimes it's a long time, but they are sure. The Jewish people were scattered. But because God made a covenant with Abram and then Abraham, we can be sure of this, that God will do what He said He will do with Abram and the Jewish people and the land. So, we see what's happening over there. You know, there's a part of us that wants to be a little bit shaken up. I admit that. There's part of me that like, what is happening? But I also know that God's in charge and His promises are faithful and true. And He stands by His people. Covenant. So I want to talk about covenant. I just talked about Abram there to establish a little bit what a covenant is. And I'll look at some of that. The first time that covenant is mentioned is after the flood, after Noah came out of the ark, it says that God said to Noah, I'm going to establish my covenant Thou shalt come into the ark, thou and thy wife and thy sons' wives with thee. After he came back out of the ark, he said, never again, and this is the covenant part, never again am I going to send a flood like this on the earth. Never again will I destroy people with a flood that covers the earth. And he said, this is my covenant that I make with mankind. And as a sign of that covenant, I'm going to put this bow up into the sky called, we call it a rainbow. And so every time you see that rainbow, you can look at that rainbow and say, God's covenant, it's his sign that never again will the earth be flooded with water. It's not going to happen. And so when you see that rainbow, you can say, wow, it's a beautiful rainbow. But you can also say, God's covenant. That's the first time covenant is mentioned in the Bible. What does covenant mean? We know what contracts are. They're agreements between people. Yesterday, we had a beautiful wedding here, Tobias, Toby, and Mary Ellen. Came together, made promises to each other, and were married. Marriage, biblical marriage, is a covenant, not a contract. And keep that in mind as I talk about covenant. Marriage, your marriage to your husband or to your wife, is a covenant, not just a contract. And it's even more than just a promise. It's a covenant that we make. A couple differences between contract and covenant. Contracts normally have a time limit written into them. And let's say this contract will end at so-and-so or when this happens. A covenant, the only thing that ends a covenant is one thing, and that's death. Death ends a covenant. And that's why marriage... That's why we stand and say, when we come to that altar, that's why we stand and say, I will love you, I will cherish you and be faithful to you until death does us part, because it's a covenant. Which brings me to the next point. A contract will have clauses in it like, if you do this, I will do this. I'll do this if you'll do this. If you don't do that, then it breaks the contract. And then the other party, the contract is broken. A covenant is you have an obligation regardless of what the other party does. When we enter into a covenant, there is an obligation that you make that remains. Regardless of what the other party does, your obligation remains. That's part of what a covenant is. In a contract, you have a signature that ratifies it. You put your name on it. On a covenant, you have a sacrifice where blood is shed, in the biblical sense of covenant, where blood is shed, and that seals the covenant. The word covenant comes from the Hebrew word, means berith, which means cutting. And I'll just explain that a little bit. And that's what happened with Abraham and with God there. God said, I make a berith with you. And so Abraham got the animals that God said, and he cut them right down the middle, laid one half on one side and one half on the other side, three of them, and then the fowl he laid to the side. And then after a while, it seems like Abraham fell into some kind of a deep sleep. But then he saw God in the form of a smoking furnace and a burning lamp that walked between those pieces. And in that, God was making a covenant with Abraham, later on with Abraham. And God said, I covenant that I will do what I say I will do. That covenant still stands. For the Jewish people in giving of the land, giving of a son, God made a covenant. And in the cutting, it's called the cutting of the covenant. And when two parties, so this was common back then, when two parties would come into covenant with each other, and I'll talk about Jonathan and David a little bit in here just in a bit. Normally both parties would walk through there. Here just God walked through and took the commitment. But when both parties would walk through, what in essence they were saying was, is if I don't keep my obligation, may I be like these animals that are slaughtered. That's what a covenant, that's why they did that. They were saying, in essence, the way that the blood of these animals have been spilt, so may my blood be spilled if I don't keep my obligation to you. It's a vast difference between a contract and a covenant. Later on, in the Old Testament, covenants were ratified with the blood of an animal. Later on, God said, now as your sign, Abraham, you'll be circumcised. So there was a shedding of blood also on Abraham's side. Now I want to talk about Jonathan and David. In 1 Samuel chapter 18, verse 1 through 4, it says like this, and it came to pass when he had made an end of speaking unto Saul, that the soul of Jonathan was knit with the soul of David, and Jonathan loved him as his own soul. And Saul took him that day and would let him go no more, this is speaking about David, would let him go no more home to his father's house. Then Jonathan and David made a covenant because he loved him as his own soul. And Jonathan stripped himself of his robe that was on him and gave it to David, and his garments, even his sword, to his bow and to his girdle. When Jonathan and David met, there was some kind of inward recognition or something. This is the first time they met. And there was an affection towards each other. And their souls were knit together to the point where Jonathan said to David, I covenant with you. Now think of this. This was Saul the king's son, who was rightfully heir to the throne. Most of the time, the king's sons would be taking over the throne. God had told Saul, because of his lack of obedience, in the case of the Amalekites, that his lineage would not continue to carry on the throne. But here Jonathan, the son of the king, had such a closeness and a bond with David that they made a covenant together. So what happened? And again, this was often what they did, is Jonathan, they exchanged robes. They exchanged weapons. And then they made a covenant. Now, the Bible doesn't say this. In one translation, it says, and they made a blood covenant. And then sometimes what they would do is cut their palms or their wrists and they would mingle their blood together. And that sealed, again, the covenant. And in this of exchanging of things, what they were saying to each other was that if you ever need defense from me, I'll come to your aid. If you ever need clothes, I'll come to you and give you clothes. If you ever need food, I'm here for you, and the other party the same way. I'm here for you. I'm here for you. That's what marriage is about. And even if the other side doesn't keep up their obligation, it's a covenant. And I know we go through things where it doesn't feel good. And then we say like this, well, you did that, then I'm going to do this. That's not a covenant. That's not a covenant. That's not a covenant attitude. It's not a covenant. It's not a way to be in your marriage. A covenant is, regardless of what the other party does, I'll do what I said I will do. And if you need help, I will be there to help. That's covenant marriage. So Jonathan and David made a covenant. Later on in Samuel chapter 20, Jonathan saw what had happened to Saul and that God's favor was resting on David. And they confirmed the covenant that they'd made. And I'm going to read this in 1 Samuel 20, 14 to 17. This is in the NIV. And do not ever cut off your kindness, Jonathan was saying, do not ever cut off your kindness from my family, not even when the Lord has cut off every one of David's enemies from the face of the earth. So Jonathan made a covenant with the house of David, saying, may the Lord call David's enemies to account. And Jonathan had David reaffirm his oath out of love for him, because he loved him even as himself. So here, Jonathan and David, again, really, I believe, reconfirmed the oath that they had made. And Jonathan, and the promise was, David, don't ever cut off your kindness to me, even to my family and to my offspring. Even when I'm gone, and you're dealing with your enemies. See, this is important, because David was going to be the next king. He was anointed to be king, and he was going to be the next king. And what the next, often when a king was new on the throne, what he would do is he would go and he would slaughter all the offspring that would have a say or a right to the throne to establish his power and his strength. You read that in various accounts in the Bible of that's what happened. A new king was put into place, and he hunted down all the sons of the previous king, or even grandsons, and had them slaughtered, so that there would be no threat to his power as king. Jonathan saw that David was king. He saw the favor of the Lord on him, and he said, remember my covenant. I want to reaffirm this covenant, that your kindness from my family, not even when the Lord has cut off every one of David's enemies from the face of the earth, that my family will be safe. And David confirmed that covenant with Jonathan. So remember that. Now later on, after Jonathan was dead, after he had died in battle, and David's kingdom was firmly established, he came to a place and he asked one of his men, he said, is there not someone from Jonathan's lineage or household that I can show favor to? Because he remembered Jonathan's kindness towards him, and his heart yearned to return again that kindness. And one of his aides said, yes, there is one by the name of Mephibosheth, and he lives over here in so-and-so place. He's one of the sons that remains from Jonathan. And so David said, have him come to the palace. Have him come to my place. And they went and they got Mephibosheth, who was lame in his feet, and his family, and they had him come to the palace. And there it says that he ate every day at the table with David. He had his feet under David's table. He was surrounded with plenty. He was surrounded with food. He was given good robes. He was given everything that could possibly be given from a royal line. Why? Because he was Jonathan's son. Mephibosheth had not done anything to earn the favor of David, other than simply being the son of Jonathan, whom David had entered into a covenant with and said, my kindness will extend to your family and to your offspring. And on that basis, Mephibosheth sat at that table day after day, eating provisions from David's table, because there was a covenant. Now, in the story of the children of Israel, you know there was a covenant that is established with Abraham. But then the children of Israel were delivered from Egypt, as God had promised. And they came to Mount Sinai. Moses led them to Mount Sinai. And there was another covenant that was established, called a covenant of law. In Exodus chapter 19, verse 5, it says, now therefore, if you will obey my voice indeed and keep my covenant, then you shall be a peculiar treasure unto me above all people, for all the earth is mine. And you shall be unto me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. These are the words which thou shalt speak unto the children of Israel. And he took the book of the covenant and read it in the audience of the people, and they said, all that the Lord has said we will do. and we will be obedient. And Moses took the blood and sprinkled it on the people and said, behold, the blood of the covenant which the Lord has made with you concerning all these words. And there was a covenant that was established that was a covenant of law. And if we would go through the whole thing, there was animals slaughtered, there was sanctification, all of those things took place, and we're not going to take the time to do all of that. So there was a covenant that was a covenant of law that was established with the Jewish people and the children of Israel. And the basis of it was this. I will bless you, God said. I will keep you. I will make you the head and not the tail. And your part is to obey my voice and to do what I tell you to do. And if you keep the words of this book, then these things will happen. Now, you might say, well, those are conditions. They are not conditions that broke the covenant. The covenant remained. Even when the children of Israel walked away from God's ways and worshiped idols, the covenant remained in place. The only thing that can break a covenant is death. But the children of Israel couldn't fulfill their part. And so the blessings of the covenant would not come on them. Didn't break the covenant. It's just the blessings of the covenant didn't come to them when they broke God's law, God's commandment. The only way out of a covenant is death. Now, so are we still under a covenant of law? Praise God, no, we're not. And Jesus in Mark chapter 14, verse 24 to 25 said like this, speaking to his disciples at the Last Supper, that time when he knew that his death was close. And they were sitting around the table and they were sharing bread. They were sharing a meal. And I think the disciples did not know really what was taking place. They didn't understand the depth of what was going on and the suffering that Jesus would experience. And as he sat there and as he shared with them, he said unto them, he said, this is as they he passed the cup around, the cup of wine that they had there. And he said, this is the blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many. Verily I say unto you, I will drink no more of the fruit of the vine until the day that I drink it new in the kingdom of God, which is quite something that Jesus said there. He would not drink wine again until he drinks it when the kingdom comes, when the fulfillment comes. But anyway, I want to talk about this where it says the blood of the New Testament, because the word testament there is the same word as covenant. It's just translated sometimes one way and sometimes another way. So Jesus said, when you drink of this cup, in another place he said, just do it in remembrance of me, in remembrance of my death, because in my death, my blood is being shed as the blood of the new covenant. Now we know that the blood, in the blood, they put it on the doorposts. And they walked through that doorpost and there was protection when the death angel came through. And we know that the blood washes our sins away. But I want to show you that there's more than just that. And I don't want to play down on that. That's not the point. The point is that Jesus has initiated a new covenant. So what happened to the old covenant? In Romans chapter 7, verse 4, it says this, wherefore, my brethren, ye are also become dead to the law by the body of Christ, that you should be married to another, even him to his raised from the dead, that we should bring forth fruit unto God. Colossians chapter 2, verse 14, blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us, which was contrary to us, took it out of the way, nailing it to his cross. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 14 says, if one died for all, then all died. What am I getting at here? The only way to come out of a covenant or to end a covenant is by death. Jesus came and he walked here. And it says in Hebrews, it also says that a body thou hast prepared me. Jesus came not as an angel, not as just as a spirit, but he came in the flesh. And the spirit of Antichrist, you see, does not want to confess this, that Jesus, that God himself in Christ, the Word, came and he walked here among us in a body of flesh. And as he walked here, he always walked obedient to the will of God. He walked in perfect righteousness before God. He fulfilled the law of God perfectly. Not once did he break a commandment. Now you might say he did, but he didn't. He obeyed the law, the spirit of the law, the heart of God, and he listened for his voice. And when God spoke, he moved. And when God said, don't move, he didn't move. And he did miracles. And he walked again, I want to say, in perfect righteousness. If he would not have, we would have no salvation. And then, when the time was right and the time had come, he was put up onto a tree, onto a cross, and there he died. And it is in that death that the end of the old covenant came. Not that the law disappeared, but the old race, the first Adam, was deadly blow of death on that cross. And in God's eyes, all of the first Adam has been dealt with. And the end of that covenant has come. And there is no way to please God with law. There is another covenant. Jesus needed a body so that he could occupy the realm that we're in. He needed a body so that he could express the image of God. He needed a body so that he could do righteous deeds while he was here. He needed a body because he was the representation of mankind that would take the sin to the cross, representing all of mankind, and this is where that covenant came to an end. He needed a body so that he'd experience what you and I experience, so that he could be a faithful high priest at the right hand of the Father. He needed a body so that he could shed blood for sin and for sins and for a new covenant. He needed a body to sacrifice. He needed a body that would bear the punishment for your sin and for my sin. Jesus. God in the flesh, God in man. And now he has established a new covenant. What I want you to see here is this. Jesus established the new covenant between God and man. Jesus represented man on the end of the old covenant. And when he rose, he represented man in new life. Because man, we fail. We try. Give us a list of things that we have to do, and we try. And the Bible says that there's nothing wrong with the law. It's holy and just. There's nothing wrong with the law. The problem lays in our fleshly nature. We find not the power to keep the rules that we want to keep. And so Jesus, as the representative of mankind, brought that old one all, not necessarily the end of the law, but brought that covenant to an end by death of a perfect body and of a perfect human being, and established a brand new covenant, a covenant of grace, really not brand new because it goes all the way back to Abram and Abraham, but established a covenant of grace where God provided. What did he provide? He provided the body. He provided the blood. He provided the sacrifice. He provided everything that was needed to enter into a new covenant with God the Father. Jesus, as the representative of mankind, entered into, as man, into a covenant with God that I give my life and you give yours to me. The covenant is with mankind, but it's through Jesus Christ, the perfect, always able, perfect man and Son of God. He's God, and yet he's man. It's a mystery to our mind. But Jesus there, you see what happened on the cross. It's a tremendous thing. One thing ended. Another thing started. I hate to call it a thing. One covenant ended and another one started. History goes one way, goes the other way. And every day we say it's 2023 is based on that point of Jesus. Jesus provided it all. That's why it's called a covenant of grace. Jesus covenanted with God the Father. Jesus the Son covenanted as the representative of man with God the Father. So where's our part? The Bible says that we are to repent, we are to believe, and be baptized. And we come into union with Christ, and we are what's called born again. And our spirit is renewed by the Holy Spirit. When we are honest and say, I have done, see, we want to try to clean ourselves all up and get all better and then say, now God, can you accept me? God says, be honest with me. Repent of your sins, confess them. Believe in what I've done. Believe in who I am. And then be joined with me in death. And as a sign of that, go down into this water, committing yourself to me, and enter into my death with me, that you are no longer living to yourself. And God does a miraculous thing and breathes into us with the Holy Spirit and gives us new life in our spirit. And there is where that new man is. And that works its way out of us. The law was trying to work its way in, but through the weakness of man could not. And then that life is within us. Now, we are in union with Christ, but the covenant is with mankind and God through Jesus Christ. And in the same way that Mephibosheth could sit at the seat or at the table of David, and there enjoy all the goodness of David's royal palace, so we can also sit at the table of God the Father and enjoy all the goodness of what Jesus has provided. Now, just because you're in a covenant does not mean that you have to take advantage of it. Mephibosheth was an offspring of Jonathan, but was not experiencing the goodness of what David had. And he could have chosen to walk away from it at any time and say, you know what, I think I'd rather just have my own provisions. I think I'd rather just kind of work and get my own stuff for my own self. And he could have done that, but it wouldn't have been very smart or very wise. And so he depended on David for his provision. There is plenty of provision in Christ. There's plenty of provision. There are robes that are clean and white where you can exchange the robe that you have tried so hard to patch and mend and do things so right for his robe. There's food at his table. There's always forgiveness if we are willing to confess and to come. It's the new covenant that we have. And it's in his blood. It's the blood of the covenant. And so when we see the blood, we know about the forgiveness of sins. But do we see how far-reaching the provision of the covenant is? And the blood is not only, it is redemption, it is forgiveness, but it is the blood of a covenant, the covenant. And God desires for us to live in the fullness of that covenant and to experience his fullness every day, to walk in it. But one of the things that troubles us often is, I'm not good enough. I'm just not good enough. That had nothing to do with Mephibosheth sitting at the table. It was because he was a son of Jonathan. And as long as we try to establish our own righteousness, if the worship team would come up, be closing here just in a little bit. And we try so hard to establish our own things, our own righteousness, when God says, no, this is why I came, this is why I died. We don't need to live in condemnation. Have your feet under the table. In conclusion, I want to just give you some differences from the old covenant to the new covenant. We live in a privileged time, church. We live in a very privileged time. Here are differences between the covenant that the children of Israel had and the covenant of grace. The mediator was Moses. Our mediator is Jesus, who lives forever at the right hand of the Father. Moses was the guide to lead them to the promised land. The Holy Spirit has been given as part of the covenant to guide us through life, to help us, to establish the nature of Christ within us. There were continual sacrifices under the old covenant all the time. Once a year, the high priest had to go in and make an offering. But always, daily, there was other sacrifices being offered. This sacrifice of Christ was once and forever sacrificed. Bulls and goats were offered. And here the body and the blood of Jesus was offered. There was a yearly reminder of sins. I kind of touched on that. And here God says in this covenant, I will not remember their sins and iniquities anymore. In that continual offering of the old, in the old covenant, it was always a reminder, you know what, we're really sinful people. John said, when he saw Jesus, he said, behold, it's the Lamb of God who will take away the sin of the world. Not just cover it up, but take it away. This is the new covenant of grace. There's not a reminder every year that's been dealt with. Better promises. Their promises were land. Their promises were blessing. Their promises were all the good things that were, if you go back and read, and I think it's Deuteronomy chapter 28, I think. But these are better promises. Promises of eternal life. A gift, an inheritance of eternal life. There, the law was written on stone. Here, it's written in your heart. In your heart, my heart, on fleshly tablets of the heart. That was just the shadow of things. We live in the dispensation of the reality that Jesus has come. There the high priest continually stood. Jesus is seated at the right hand of the Father. Only the high priest had access into the Holy of Holies. Here we have boldness. Boldness to enter into the Holy of Holies by the blood of Jesus. Because of the covenant. There God was distant. Here we have God and we know Him as Father. And we can go to Him as Father. And experience Him as Father. Abba, Father. It was a covenant of death. This is a covenant of life. It's the old man, it's the new man. It's the covenant of law and the covenant of grace. God has provided a tremendous way, the covenant of grace. Forgiveness of sins, washing away of sins, dealing with the old man, the Holy Spirit to guide us and to lead us. We live in a wonderful, wonderful time. Believe. You will never be good enough to say, now I'm good enough to sit at the table. You will never be good enough for that, not in your own being. But if you are an offspring of Christ, you have a seat at the table. God bless you. Turn the time over to the worship team.
Rivers in their heights, no longer dry. The desert is kind of like. Thank you, Brother Steve, for the message, for the studies you put into that. Thank you so much. I remember years ago when I came across the scripture there in Genesis, first time, where I saw the furnace of God going down through the middle of the spine. And I think this is the reason the Christian life doesn't work so well for many people, because they have not truly severed the spine in their own lives. You see, you can give your hand to Christ. He's not looking for your hand. He's looking to go right down the center of your spinal cord and divide that. And when the spinal cord is severed right through the middle, none of your hands work, none of your feet work, nothing works. And it is only then that God, through the power of the Holy Spirit, as a furnace of fire, will walk through the middle of you. And now you'll be able to walk the way God wants you to walk. I remember when that happened. The covenant is a wonderful thing that God made with man. But if you do not make the covenant with Him, it's just not going to work for you. You struggle with some things, you struggle with this, you struggle with this, struggle with this. But there comes a time, all of us people, where we need to be severed right down the middle. For all the strength. You can give your hand to God, you can give your eyes to God, you can do all that. But there has to come a place and a time for a complete death in our own Christian life or in our own life. And it's at that time that the furnace of fire walks through us. And I remember the exact spot that happened to me. And my life was never the same since. And I think that's the big challenge, to enter into this covenant with Him. This has to stop, and that is our own life. We have to come to a total death. Amen. And then that furnace of fire walks through. Yeah? This is why so many people struggle in their Christian life. And it's just the promises, they look good, they sound good, but they don't work for me. They work for others, I see that, but they don't work for me. Well, there's probably still something working in your own life, could even be your own opinion. Notice there's two doves. There is two birds that were not separate. And that has to do with the mind and the spirit. Those are two things that will always fly. They will always move. Those were not severed. But as far as the flesh man, that was severed. And God had that done to make the covenant with Israel. And then in our personal lives, He's not asking for one person to do that in one, but it's our individual lives that we all have to come to that place of total death. And then He'll visit us through the furnace. God bless you so much for coming. And we'll just close in prayer yet. Father, we thank You for this time, wonderful message that Steve gave. And Lord, the beautiful things that you've done, all the technicalities that you have made in the spiritual realm from the old covenant to the new covenant to our present day. And we thank you, Father, that you are not a sloppy God. You're not a God that overlooks things. You have every last detail put in place because there is a devil that questions everything you'll ever do. And he will try to fight technicalities so that he can keep his power in people's lives to hinder. But Father, we thank you that you have exemplified so clearly that in your Son, Jesus, he died. And he died the three-day death. He was in that tomb for 3 nights, 3 days. And we also know, Lord, there is 3 specific animals that had to die right down through the middle before the resurrection, which is the power of the Holy Spirit, came. And so it is in our lives, Father. I pray that you would look into people's lives today and allow people to search their own hearts and see if is there anything that I have not completely given up, laid down, severed, come to a final halt and death. And then the divine visitation from heaven. God, as the spirit of, as a furnace of fire, I will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. Father, we know that it is your Holy Spirit that is the priest of the new covenant today. And he lives in our lives, gives us power to overcome. Power in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. We thank you. Thank you for everything that was said today, for all the different things that were done. To you be all the honor and to you be all the glory. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. And you're dismissed.